Stop sharing your fucking walkie.
Good morning, and welcome to A Conversation with the Chef. I want to encourage everyone to like and share our Facebook Live video, as well as send any questions that you have. I am Patricia Johnson, and I serve as the Manager of Community Relations at the Community Council of Greater Dallas. The Community Council has been serving Dallas for over 80 years. Our mission is to move individuals and families from surviving to thriving. Some of our programs are the Dallas Area Agency on Aging, our senior program, 211. It is an information and referral number that you can call about resources in your local community. Economic mobility. This program allows us to engage individuals and help build opportunities such as work, career, education, childcare, transportation, just to name a few. Lastly, our community wellness program. We promote healthy living and we offer educational classes such as diabetes, chronic disease, chronic pain, falls prevention, medication review. And in 2015, the National Institutes of Health launched the All of Us Research Program. And we became a partner, a community partner of the CPGI in 2017, which I'm proud to be a part of. The All of Us Research Program is inviting 1 million people across the United States to be one of the most diverse databases in history. This database will help researchers learn the factors that impact our health and find new ways to treat and prevent disease. Through this research, we have learned that eating healthy reduces our risk of chronic conditions, and it plays an important role to us living healthier lives. So over the last few months, we partnered with nutritionist Paul Ritter to discover ways to start eating healthy. He demonstrated quick and easy recipes to help us cook nutritious, balanced meals. He gave us pointers, and yes, he told us some things that we don't need to do. So today, we will talk with Paul Ritter and producer Troy Knowles and revisit some of our cooking segments. Thank you for joining us today, Troy.
All right, Paul.
Good morning, good morning, good morning, and welcome back. I am so excited today to do a recap of the few months of cooking that we've done. I want to thank the Community Council first and foremost and the All of Us Research Project. I want to thank Jessica, Mike, Patricia, and everyone behind the scenes, OG Troy Knowles directing, taking questions, and I just want to thank you guys for tuning in, and I hope and pray that over the last few months, the cooking shows that we've done, the information that I've shared, that you've gleaned a little knowledge on how to be quick in the kitchen, and at the same time, how it can be healthy, and last but not least, how it can be very inexpensive. So today, we're just going to kind of review the four shows that we've done. I brought some seasonings and ingredients to remind you guys of, and you know, if you got questions, feel free to jump in with us. Also, just remind, go to the page, All of Us Research Program, Community Council, click on donate, share, because we need you to make this program successful. We need you so we can come up with better alternatives for our community, for medicines, and just a variety of different issues that we're facing in this time that we're living in. So we want to thank you for tuning in, but at the same time, we want you to become a participant. We want you to get involved, get active, sign up, get your family in it, so then we can do much more to help you. So with that said, we're just going to kind of touch on everything we've done. You know, the first class that we started with was Memories of Christmas Past. We talked about food for the holidays. We talked about candy yams, how we can make them better. We did cranberry sauce and different things like that. And then from there, we went to New Year, New Food, y'all, where I challenged all of you to start incorporating more greens in your life every day. 3 to 5 greens in your life every day, whether it's some greens in a smoothie, greens in a salad, and then at night doing something simple, whether it's green beans, broccoli, asparagus, saute some cabbage really quick. And then from New Year, New Food, y'all, we went to, you know, my favorite month, February, Black History Month. Food for Your Soul, where I demonstrated how to make a somewhat healthy macaroni and cheese. Do y'all remember that? Where we use rice milk and whole wheat pasta noodles and unsalted butter and things of that nature, a higher quality cheese. So we get the same taste, we get the same flavor, but we don't get the same effect on our body.
What's that effect? What's the effect on the body? What was the effect that we were getting?
So with the macaroni and cheese that I share with you guys how to make, if you do not remember, go back to the community council page, go back to my Facebook page, you can watch it all. Because the ingredients were cleaner, Troy, just doesn't make you feel as doesn't make you feel as sleepy. Right. You don't want to fall asleep after a few bites. And at the same time, it allows your body to break it down so you could eliminate it easier. You know, in the Food for Your Soul, we also did some collard greens without the fat back, without the pork, because in that, in the greens, we use the seaweed that acts as a great tenderizer. Pacific kombu, let's pull it out again so you can see it, acts as a great tenderizer, gives you all the salt flavor, but more importantly, doesn't raise blood pressure, doesn't retain any weight. And at the same time, this has all the iodine that you need. You know, also in the greens that day, we use Bragg liquid aminos, which is a great alternative to salt. For those of you that are challenged with high blood pressure, we also use Bragg. You see, you get the theme, y'all, you get the theme. We use Bragg's apple cider vinegar, acts as a tenderizer, not only for greens and vegetables, but for meat. If you go back and watch the cooking show, I used this on chicken. I marinated it. And so it's just a great, great thing. And then we have some other seasonings here that I'm going to tell you about today that we didn't discuss. And one is Bragg's Nutritional Yeast. Now, I want you to get a good look at this. This is yellow. And this acts like cheese for those of you that want burgers. Really inexpensive, guys. So if you're making a turkey burger at home for your kids and you're trying to minimize the cheese intake with your family, just sprinkle this over the burger when it's in the skillet, and you'll be amazed to how they will not know the difference. I promise you, if you don't show it to them, they will not know the difference. So here's another great little ingredient that you will love. So Bragg's Nutritional Yeast, it's a fantastic, fantastic season. And I just wanted to show you some other things. Bragg's has a great 24 spice. It's 24 herbs and spices.
Hold on, Paul. I got to stop Paul, because Paul running, right? He forgot that, you know, I'm actually billed on this show too. Normally I'm behind the scenes, but hey, my name is Troy Knoll. They call me OG Troy Knoll. It's only because I have a son who's better looking, more popular, and more talented. So I had to be the original, right? But I want to do a little housekeeping while I have you here. I'm glad everyone's here at this wrap up show. First of all, I want to welcome Paul to my kitchen.
There we go. We're in OG Knoll's kitchen, y'all. We are here live making it happen.
Yeah, and you know, so we're looking at the Facebook comments. We're looking at YouTube. So if you got questions, go ahead and ask them. But before you get too far, I want to replay a section from one of the broadcasts, and it was really about the one that just surprised me the most. It was about the seaweed. Hold on a second.
Once again, we want our collard greens to have flavor. And just in the African-American community, we are so used to doing, y'all know pork. Y'all know we talked about pork on the previous shows. We may revisit it today if we have a little time. We like to put some pork in there, some ham hocks and things of that nature. Or even if you're trying to move healthier, you may say, you know what? I'll put some turkey in there. Turkey give it a little flavor. Well, today we're going to walk you a little further down the road. So we're not doing pork. We're not even going to do turkey. We're going to do seaweed. Why are we doing seaweed? Because this is going to give amazing flavor. Absolute amazing flavor. So seaweed is great. It also.
So what was it about the seaweed that just that you loved?
So the seaweed, guys, is just, first of all, it's never been processed or contaminated. So therefore, it's just in its natural element. And the amazing thing is all salt that you consume, everybody, that you shake out of all these different shakers, starts here. starts right here. So because this hasn't been processed or manipulated, it's good for the body. And so you can use this on cabbage, beans, rice, soups, and it just gives great flavor, tenderizes, gives you the salt flavor, but it's not harmful for the body. So once again, when you're just doing things of rice, beans, soups, greens, just drop some in and you'll be amazed on how much flavor it gives to the food. So that's one thing I want you guys to just keep in mind, very inexpensive, guys. This is not an expensive product. This costs you about, I think it's about $5.30. You can get it from your Whole Foods, you can get it from your Sprouts, natural grocers, stores of that nature. And it's just a simple product that allows, you know, one of the things I've focused on in 16 years, going on 17 years of teaching health and wellness, is that you want it to taste good so you can maintain the lifestyle. So that's why the seaweed is so important. And so we had, of course, like I said, we had Food for Your Soul in February, and then we finished it up with Cooking for the Fiesta. And we really focused on foods for that community. And it was great because, once again, we did refried beans and we did a Mexican salad with black beans and corn and all type of stuff, avocado. And so I know Troy has got some clips that he probably wants to show y'all. So
I do. And before I go to the clip I really want to show you,
okay,
is I want to talk about, it seems like a common theme. It seems like in our cultures, in the Hispanic cultures, in the Black community, we look at being sleepy as a sign that the food was good, when really that's the problem. And I think what you were saying is about the amounts of dairy, right?
So, okay. So here we go, y'all. Here we go. If you have your notepads out, I'm gonna break this down so you understand it. The reason why we get sleepy is we attribute that to, oh, the food was so good. Oh my God, yeah, this is just amazing. No, the reason why we get sleepy is because your pancreas is having to work so hard to break down the food. You know, your pancreas produces insulin. So what's happening is your pancreas is so overworked that it gets tired, and that tiredness is relayed to the whole body. And so therefore, i.e., after we eat a big meal on Sunday, we start to doze off into sleep, as opposed to, and the reason why is because most good meals are saturated in fat and high in salt. And those two things cause the pancreas to overwork, a la pushes us down the road to being diabetic quicker and sooner after each meal. So when we just minimize or eliminate the fat, minimize most likely, we can't probably eliminate it completely, we reduce the salt, we eat a cleaner version of sugar, then your pancreas goes, oh, I can break this down really easy, and it allows our energy level to stay high, as opposed to Troy, you know, after we eat, you know, it's like on Sunday, oh, you know what, I just need to sit down for a minute, give me a second. So when we change how we prepare the foods, we can still keep the quality of taste, but we don't compromise our health.
Paul, that was good. And we got visitors and people. We got visitors who are chiming in from all over. Paula D. Johnson says hello from Houston. And Jessica says, good job, Troy. I'm sure she thought you were doing is good too, but you know, since we're in my house, she said hello to the host first, right? And we got Olaf from Monique Smith, but I want to play this clip. And FYI, my mother called me.
She did call you. She got in. We got Mama in. So Mama, we always love when you are watching.
Yeah. And so I might have Mom call back in and say hello. But I wanted to play this clip talking about dairy. Then we'll have you kind of address that as well.
Now, the other area that dairy plays a major role in our society, guys, is from simple things that we think are controlled outside of dairy, i.e. sinus issues, allergies, asthma, dairy is the root cause of all of that. You go, well, wait, no, no. You go, no, Paul, no, no, no. I have allergy issues because of the season. No, you have allergy issues because your autoimmune system is not functioning at the level that it should, and that is caused directly from too much dairy consumption. Now you say, okay, Paul, well, what is dairy? Yes, butter is dairy. Now, as long as we're only using a minimal amount, I'll let you slide on that. But when I say dairy on an everyday use, we're talking about pizza, mac and cheese, which we all love for the holidays, all of the different creamy dressings from ranch to Thousand Island, all of those creamy things. If you're in Texas, like where we are, you know, Mexican food is huge here in Texas. And they tend to put cheese on everything, cheese on the beans, cheese on the rice, cheese on the meat, cheese on everything. Guess what? Now, this might offend some of you out there, but guess what? Milk is a big dairy product. Now, you're saying, well, what would be a better choice? There's a product called rice milk. It's going to give you all the same nutritional supplementation that your body needs, but at the same time, it's lactose-free, dairy-free, cholesterol-free. And so dairy is going to be one of the big, big things that I'm going to challenge you to minimize.
So we've had people making comments. Paula said she took your advice to start drinking rice milk, right? And we talked about dairy. I thought I was asthmatic because I just had asthma. You're saying
it just fell on me, so I got it.
I just thought I had it. But you're saying it's the amount of dairy, right?
Yeah. So on just touching again on dairy, guys, understand dairy is creamy. Dairy looks good. They put it on TV for us in every commercial, every venue. But understand now, I want to make this really clear. Dairy is the second leading cause of every cancer. Mm. Dairy has twice as much cholesterol as any meat. And so for alternative choices, the one I tell everyone to do, because I truly believe and understand it is the cleanest of all the milk substitutes, is rice milk. And, you know, you can get the brand Rice Dreams. If you're going to do butter, take a baby step and do unsalted butter.
What about vegan butter?
Vegan butter is good, but make sure you're getting a true vegan butter. So if you're going to do a vegan butter, I would encourage Earth Balance because they make a really clean version. Many times companies now are jumping in this whole healthy, clean lifestyle, but they're really not what they say they are. So how do you know? I always tell people it's really simple. Just read the ingredients. The ingredients should be very simple. The words should be understandable. And it shouldn't be anything that you can't pronounce or can't depict. But yeah, so understand, though, that dairy is the root cause of sinus and allergies. Everyone that has asthma, that's a dairy issue. You know, you don't have asthma because of the weather or the grass or the ragweed or anything of that nature. You have dairy because you have asthma because you consume too much dairy products. And that dairy is it's a broad span. It's a large, large category. Mm-hmm. Ranch dressing, mayonnaise, macaroni and cheese, creamer in your coffee, broccoli and cheese, chicken tetrazzini, Doritos, Cheetos, cheese popcorn. You know, it's such a large spectrum. So I'm not going to tell you never to eat it, but if you know you're having some health challenges, if you find yourself constipated more than normal, there's a better than zero chance that you're consuming too many dairy products. So you're going to need to back away. And also you'll see an improvement in your health. You won't be as sluggish. You'll feel better. You'll lose weight. So just pull back from the dairy somewhat.
What about the coffee creamers? Like, because Cynthia Franklin is working on reducing coffee creamers.
Okay, so once again, use rice milk. Rice milk has multiple flavors. It has an unsweet, has an original, has a vanilla. And I know some of you are out there saying, well, what about almond milk or soy milk or oat milk? Those are better choices than milk, But at the same time, depending on your health situation, that should decide which product you use. If you know you're trying to lose weight, if you have a blood pressure or a cholesterol issue, then I'm going to tell you rice milk right off the top.
Well, I tell you what, back to the asthma, Jessica asked, what about wheezing? Is that from having all that thick fluid?
That's a thick, and that's a mucus issue. And that goes back to there's something you're consuming that's causing that. And so many times we medicate ourselves through the medical profession because we have an issue. We go, oh, I'm wheezing, let me go get a medicine. Oh, I'm coughing, let me go to, oh, I'm feeling bad, let me go get this. As opposed to taking an internal look at ourselves saying, what did I do to cause this? And if you figure out what you did to cause it, all you have to do is stop and the issue goes away.
Yeah.
But many times we have an issue and then we pile another issue on top of it. And so you never get to the root of it. And then that becomes your habit. And when that becomes your habit, you stay habitually sick.
You know what? Growing up with asthma, you know, we drink a lot of milk and the milk lobby is amazing. Got milk and then the milk mustache. And show people who were looked to be healthy were consumers of milk.
Right.
So what we say is we really can't trust our advertisers or even the FDA what's good.
Not
for
at all. Because I'll give you guys this. And, you know, many of you know that follow me. Shout out to everyone out there that's watching. I use Whole Foods as an example a lot of times. But if you think back 5 or 6 years ago, you never saw a commercial about Whole Foods grocery stores. Now that Amazon has bought them, now you see more because they put more in advertising. But you never saw a commercial about Whole Foods or Sprouts or a natural grocer or a sunflower shop. But these places have been around for 30, 40, 50 years. And that's because they want to give us an image of health that's not necessarily accurate. Mm. And so, once again, you have to be your own best doctor when it comes to just understanding what's causing some of the challenges that you're having. You know, I'll say this for those of you that are trying to lose weight, y'all might click off right after I say this, but I love y'all and y'all can click back on any minute. No one makes you eat what you eat. It's a choice. Now, many times those choices come from stress, come from lifestyle, come from family, but it is a choice. So what I always try to provide for people is not so much deprivation as a different choice. And in the different choice, you feel better. You have more energy. You think better. I'm going to give a quick plug, and I think Troy's got another clip.
Well, I'm thinking about the choice. So you give me a choice between a cookie and a cracker. Like, I'll be like, yeah, did I really have a choice? Like,
right.
With all the advertising towards kids, like the Happy Meal is probably the number one meal among
McDonald's children. Jingle. Every kid knows the McDonald's jingle at 2 years old.
Yeah.
And so when it comes to the choices.
So choices, how much of it is programming? How much of it is addiction? It's like they said, I've never done cocaine, but they said sugar is 8 times more addictive. I've done a lot of sugar.
Right.
I've done a lot of sugar up in here.
and it is because foods give us a feeling. And from that feeling, we either like it or we don't. But food gives you a feeling. Mm-hmm. You know, think about it. I'm a French fry lover, y'all. I'm not going to lie. I love hot French fries. Love it. Now, I'm very selective where I buy my French fries at, but I love hot French fries.
I know you ain't getting French fries from Whole Foods. Like, where are you getting French fries
if
from?
If I get some hot French fries, y'all, I pull over and I'm like, you know what? God is good.
Hey, Cynthia, I don't know if like Cynthia and Frankie said save us, but like where are the fries that won't kill you but taste good?
I mean, once again, I'm not the guy to say you never eat out. So believe it or not, when I'm getting French fry, I'm going to higher quality restaurants. So guess what? It's not a drive-through fry, y'all. Mm-mm, not a drive-through fry because y'all ain't eating real potatoes. So let me.
Hold on, man. Hold on. Chick-fil-A closed on Sunday. Right. And they got the, like, come on, them waffle fries. That ain't Jesus.
So I go to a restaurant where I can sit down at a table where they actually, somebody back there peeled some potatoes and they gonna bring me real fries. So, but yeah, guys, so in the whole.
Paul, you still have not said where you went and got the fries. I mean, you're,
so
you're
there never- are multiple places. Okay, so let me give y'all one place in North Dallas that has amazing French fries, y'all. Beck's. It's literally like a steakhouse. It's on the corner of Preston and Forest Lane. They have the most amazing fresh, real potato French fries you can eat in Dallas. Yeah. So Beck's Prime, right on the course of Forest and Preston. They have amazing French fries. Amazing French. So that's just one spot. And I got some other ones, but you know, y'all be driving all over the city because I'm not going to eat my French fries at your traditional drive-thrus with the M, Chick-fil-A, all the other spots. So,
you know what, Paul? We had like 30 people.
And we just dropped off a whole bunch. Bunch of people just left. And they probably like, oh, so, no, see.
So I do remember when we were going through, we were losing fans little by little. Sure. And in the soul, food for your soul, we lost a lot of people at the pork argument, right? So I'm going to play a clip from, our addiction to pork or what we, you know, because everything that we, you know, to make the greens taste good.
Make the greens taste good. Everything comes from pork. That's how we were raised.
So here we go.
I know we have always lived on ham, but I'm going to challenge everybody out there this year, move away from the pork. And the reason why, there are three simple things about pork. Number one, the pig has no immune system, so it can't kill anything. Number two, the pig carries 18 to 20 parasites and worms that never die. And if any of you want to try this wonderful experiment, if you have any type of pork in your home, put it in a skillet similar to one of these over here. Put it in a skillet, burn it up really crisp, and then put it in a Ziploc bag and let it sit there for 3 to 4 days. And watch what happens in the Ziploc bag. You're gonna be shocked because you're gonna see some things moving around in that Ziploc bag that you didn't see when that pork was in the skillet. Lastly, when it comes to pork, the pig is the number one carrier of arthritis in the animal kingdom. So how does that play out? Very simply, because arthritis is not a hereditary issue. Arthritis comes from our nutritional choices that we have done from memories of Christmas past.
Pork, the other white meat. you said a few things, and I hope no one did that experiment. I'm just gonna take your word. If I put, you know, some pork in a bag for 4 days, I'm just gonna take your word for it. I don't wanna see it, you know? So,
right.
So what did you do to overcome the pork?
So for me, one of the things I always like to stress, knowledge is power. And once I get enough knowledge about a situation, I can take control over it. So I'll be very transparent. When I first started teaching health and wellness, I still ate pork. Because I love pork chops. I love ham. I love chitlins, believe it or not. I actually grew up eating chitlins. But as I continually got more information and more knowledge on what it does to the body, one day I just stopped. And I've never gone back. And it wasn't because anyone forced me or anything. So that goes back to the previous segment we were talking about. If you're trying to lose weight, if you're trying to get off medication, if you have a blood pressure issue, a cholesterol issue, a diabetic issue, or any type of health issue, an autoimmune issue, number one, get more educated about it. As opposed to just many times we just run out and go grab something off a shelf and we educate ourselves on the medication, but we don't educate ourselves on our own choices and what they do to the body. So knowledge is power, to answer Troy's question, how did I do it? And so the more information I got, it was easy. It was very same thing with dairy. The more information I got on dairy and understood that as I've grown in this career and in this lifestyle, the more clients that kept getting referred to me that have cancer issues, whether it's breast, prostate, ovarian, you name it, I've dealt with it. They were all dairy lovers. It was they were all major dairy lovers. And so once again, the more knowledge we get, the easier it is for us to change our choices.
Yeah. Well, I got a friend who jumped on the live, a good friend of mine from California. He's a Marine and he works out all the time. Mm-hmm. But what I've been told is you can't outwork a bad diet.
No, you cannot. Not only can you not outwork a bad diet, it will give a misrepresentation because you'll see someone and they'll have muscles and be fit And I always say you're fit physically, but internally you're a mess. Your internal environment is chaotic. So I'm all about exercise. I personally train people, athletes, I've done it for years. But more importantly, in this stage of life, I'm all about what goes in every day.
Yeah.
And when you can switch the focus to being more internally focused than outwardly focused, you feel better. You can move around better. And then you add the exercise and the walking, the fit training. Now you've got the complete package.
Yeah.
You know, I use this, I'll take a biblical reference. If you are someone that has studied the Bible, read the Bible over years and years, you know, it's interesting because in all aspects of the Bible, wisdom comes before wealth.
Mm. Say that again.
Wisdom comes before wealth.
Okay.
And if you study the Bible, everyone that accumulated great wealth, they had to get the wisdom first. And now if you translate that to today's society, it's the same way.
Right.
Bill Gates has so much wisdom, he's one of the richest people in the world. Elon Musk has so much wisdom, he's one of the richest people in the world. So if you can get the wisdom on your health and on food, then your health will become your wealth.
Or it should, because you meet a lot of rich people who have heart attacks.
Right.
Because they eat so opulently, if that's a word.
Exactly, yeah. Exactly. But yeah. You also find a lot of people that are extremely wealthy live a lot longer than we do.
Because they get that good food.
Because they're shopping at a Whole Foods every day, and they're shopping at Central Market, and they're shopping different places. They're not shopping at Walmart.
Yeah. No shot to Walmart.
No shot to Walmart. You know, y'all have some things that everybody needs.
Got a good question. I started plant-based 2 years ago, but now I'm challenged with having to create good meals because they just don't want just to keep on eating a piece of celery. You know what I'm saying?
Right. And so one of the things that I try to do in lots of variety. So whoever that person that had the plant-based.
Paula.
Reach out to me privately, Paula, and I'll be more than happy to send you a lot of recipes. You can reach out to me. For those of you who don't know, you can find me on Instagram at pritter2355. Of course, Facebook, paulritter2023 on Twitter, LinkedIn. If you want to email me, it's pritter2355@gmail.com. And I'll be more than happy to send you more recipes, ideas, or just go to my Instagram page. You'll see a lot of meals on there, a lot of pictures of food. And if you don't know exactly how to put it together, shoot me a message. I'll tell you how to cook it. And so now
I just want to.
You got another question, Troy?
Yeah. Because Clifton, I love cookies.
Cookies.
And sweets, right? But right below that is cheese.
Okay.
And we live in the Southwest and they put cheese on everything.
Everything.
They fry everything and you can get fried cheese. Right. And so what are some of the alternatives to a cheeseburger?
OK, so
macaroni and cheese.
OK, so once again, I'm going to come back to this product here. I want everybody to get a good look at this. Bragg's Nutritional Yeast. If you just have to have a burger with some cheese on it, as you're frying the burger, sprinkle some of this. It's Bragg's Nutritional Yeast. This is good for the body. I don't have enough time to really break it down, but it is absolutely amazing for the body. So you can use this to replace your cheese. And then once again, when it comes to just making better choices, weigh it out. You know, someone said he liked cookies. So Clifton, if you like cookies, then let's find a way to make the cookie healthier. You know, one of the sweeteners that I use. let's just say, Clifton, let's say I'm just gonna make you a oatmeal raisin cookie.
Amen.
Oatmeal raisin cookie. So instead of white flour, I'm gonna get whole wheat flour. Instead of white sugar, I'm gonna use raw sugar, or I'm gonna use brown rice syrup. You know, I'm gonna go get a cleaner raisin. I'm gonna get some good raisins. For the batter, instead of using the milk, I'm going to use the rice milk in it. Unsalted butter will go in that. What else do I do? You want to get flour, self-rising flour. You can get a clean version of a self-rising flour. Egg. Once again, you want to get a brown egg instead of a white egg. What am I missing for oatmeal raisin cookie? And so when you batter it up, put it on the cookie sheet. Now watch this. Don't spray Pam on the cookie sheet. I know we grew up using Pam and all of that stuff. Just take a little grapeseed oil and put it on there because that's the best cooking oil, regardless what you're doing. And then scoop the batter out, put it on the cookie sheet. Oh, you need some oatmeal mix. That's right, you need oatmeal mix. I'm doing this off the top of my head, y'all. We are live.
Yeah, if you're doing oatmeal cookies, you're going to need some oatmeal.
Yeah, you're going to need some oatmeal mix. And then might be missing one other two things, but then mix it all up together, guys. Put it on the cookie sheet. Bake the cookies, and I promise you, you will be amazed at the taste, and it'll just be a cleaner version. So, once again, not deprivation, not saying you can't have cookies or things that of that nature. Let's just find a way to make them better.
I will tell you, Paula makes a comment about black bean brownies, and they are, my wife makes them, they're super good. But we have a really interesting comment because of when a person goes from young and big and strong to trying to be longevity. So my friend Marquise Golston, he's a retired Marine. He said, I used to focus on building muscles for a year. Now my outlook is longevity and quality of life. Mm-hmm. I still lift a few times a week to maintain the muscle mass, but I no longer restrict my cardio. Mm-hmm. Taking a slightly leaner appearance for a longer life. So he can be active in his 60s, 70s, 80s. Right. And accountability comes easy when you take care. Right. And this journey has become easier for you because you don't seem like you struggle with eating well.
No, because once again, I've been doing it for 16 years. But to what Maurice says,
Marquise,
sorry about that. Here's your template, your goal. Now, you might not reach it, but this is what to strive for. You should try to get back almost to your high school size. He said, well, wait a minute, Paul. I know some of you ladies said, well, I done had some kids. I did a lot of stuff. Because the less weight that your body carries, the less struggle your heart has. Mm. And as we get older, we don't exercise as much. We tend to eat out more for convenience because we don't have the energy to cook and prepare meals on a daily basis. So note to self. You want to consciously work on getting leaner as you get older because it's less stress on your heart. Because heart disease we have more heart disease than we have AIDS. You know, but high blood pressure is like the common cold now. You know, we have gotten so comfortable with saying, oh, I'm just going to eat this and take my blood pressure pill later. Well, maybe you shouldn't eat that so you don't have to take a blood pressure pill later. You know, we have to shift our mentality on how we look at food, how we look at our bodies. We only get one. It's not like a car where you can trade it in and out. And we can't trade it in and out. You get one. That's it. It's not a test drive. It's not a, oh, you know what? I think I want to be 6'3 now and 195 pounds. No. You are what you are. So you have to be more accountable to yourself. And when you are, then you'll feel better.
Yeah, talking about accountability because, Paul, you know, you say you only get one, but I know a whole bunch of surgeons in Miami and people flying down there trying to, but it's not fixing the inside.
Right. And it's still that same body. They might do some cosmetics, but it's that same body. Yes, indeed.
Well, here, I wanted to, we got a couple more questions, but I wanted to play a clip. I've learned a lot. This has been a very fun project. A lot of times you work and then you work with people you like you, and then you have fun and you learn. And to have fun and learn at the same time, this should be like the whole curriculum, right?
Right.
But it was the fiesta. We live in the Southwest.
Right.
Yeah, it was and Hispanic food, Mexican food, Peruvian food, Salvadorian food is just so good. But it's not really made with as much cheese as we make it here.
Right.
So I'm gonna play a clip about fiesta. And I really like this one partly because I got to eat the results. Here we go.
Focused on many different cultures. Today, we're going to focus on the Mexican community and just some of their traditional food. So today, y'all, we're going to have a blast. We're going to kill it. Let me tell you, we got some fish tacos. We got some refried beans. We got a black bean salad and some Spanish rice. And in the background, our director's already been getting down on the tortilla chips and the salsa. We are in like literally the Mexican belt. Dallas, every other restaurant, every other block, You see tons of Mexican places to eat at. One of the big challenges with Mexican food is the dairy intake that we tend to associate with Mexican food. We tend to put dairy on the beans and the rice. We tend to put dairy on the side, whether it's sour cream and different things and different bowls, like when we're doing our burrito bowls or different things like that. So the biggest takeaway, so it doesn't make you feel so heavy, doesn't make you feel so sleepy, doesn't just take so much for your body to break it down, is minimize the dairy. On the other side of that, Mexican foods are famous for lots of onions and bell peppers and beans, which are great for you, and rice, which is great for you. The challenge is many times it's a white rice or a Spanish rice. Well, today, the rice that I'm using is Spanish rice, but it's brown rice. And I'm also going to use the brown rice for the fish tacos. So if we just make a couple little tweaks, not only you still get the same taste, the same flavor, but it just minimizes the elevation of blood pressure, the putting on of weight. We've got fish tacos, black beans, refried beans, Spanish rice. Eliminate the whipped cream and the cheese. And we've got an incredible Hispanic meal. And Troy is literally taking one right now. He literally just took one off the plate, y'all.
Delicious.
And just bit into it right in the middle of the cooking show.
You, I kind of wish I would have had you cooking over here, because that one was good. That, you know, and you know, I'm gonna go over a couple of comments. Jessica said high school, like, you know, like that was 1986. So, you know, I didn't have any, I was all skin and bones. You saying get back to that?
Right.
High school.
Like, yeah, you want to focus on trying to get closer to your high school weight, because it just will allow your body to operate better. I don't know how many of you out there have challenges with energy, with digestion, with elimination. All of that has a direct correlation to everything we've been talking about for the last 4 weeks, 4 months, really.
Yeah, Marquis said, I'm considering vegetarian or pescatarian route. Any thoughts or personal preferences?
No, you can do either or. I'm not a vegetarian, but I eat a lot of vegetables. You know, I always tell people, if you're going to do the pescatarian route, make sure you just educate yourself. Because many times when people decide to say, I'm going to be vegan or vegetarian or whatever, you're still incorporating things that aren't giving you the chance to be, to have optimum health. So, no, you know, if you're going to do pescatarian, nothing wrong with that. If you're just going to eat fish, just make sure you're eating all the clean fish, you know, whether it's Chilean sea bass, wild salmon, cod. Sable fish is a clean fish. You may not have heard about it a lot. Black drum is a clean fish. Red snapper is a clean fish.
So wait, what about you know, the staple?
See, here we go. Here we go, y'all. Friday, everybody want to eat catfish. So
thank you, Paula.
See, Paula, I already knew where he's going with that. Catfish is not clean. Tilapia is not clean. Now, they taste really good. And I know most Fridays in Dallas, everybody run into a catfish shack. But once again, having a lifestyle of good choices. Now, if 6 days a week you're doing right and Friday you want to have some catfish, okay, knock yourself out. But if you know you partake in catfish or tilapia multiple times a week, there's no coincidence that your cholesterol is probably elevated.
Because Paul, I'm going to interrupt you. Because I've been really good this week. So pop that door open in the refrigerator.
Uh-huh.
Open it up. I want to see. Open it all the way.
All the way.
And you see. Well, we lost that one.
Okay.
So put that back on top. I forgot about that. Uh-huh. But you see that celery thing right there? I want you to straight ahead.
Right here.
Pull that out. That's okay. What I've been eating all week. My wife said it was going to help with my inflammation. She got on this inflammation kick.
Okay. And, okay. So here we go.
That's what I've been eating all week.
Okay. Has it helped?
I don't know, because it wasn't, I felt like I was cool. That's what she just said, hey, baby, eat this. This is this.
Okay.
I got on this inflammation kit.
Okay. Right? Gotcha.
So, you see that?
Right. It's celery and carrots.
Celery and carrots. Yeah. So now, Catfish Friday.
Catfish Friday. Well, that's a personal choice. So and let me help you out. For those of you that maybe having some inflammation issues, and inflammation tends to correlate with digestion. How do we get rid of inflammation? We have to increase our magnesium, because magnesium is anti-inflammatory. And do we get magnesium? We can get it from one or two ways. We can start eating a lot of greens, which is going to take a little longer to break down in the body. When I say a lot of greens, cabbage, kale, leeks, bok choy, chard, baby bok choy, mustard greens, red cabbage, or let me break this product down. You can get a magnesium oxide. It's a simple product, and I'll be doggone if Troy and them don't have some. They got some over here in the kitchen.
Here it is
right here, guys. Magnesium oxide. This is the best product if anyone is having inflammation or digestive issues. Why? Because it's got one ingredient on the back of this, y'all, magnesium. Mm. And so you find magnesium in all of your dark green vegetables. If you take about a half teaspoon of that, then mix it up with some apple juice, cranberry juice, or you just want to mix it in water. It's just going to taste like chalk. And drink it down. Do it every day. You'll be amazed how inflammation will go away. Digestive issues will go away. Magnesium is also the key component to heart health. When you get enough magnesium in your body, you cannot have a heart attack or stroke. That has been medically proven. Mm. Magnesium also helps you sleep better. So, you know, that will help on that.
That sounds like a miracle drug.
It's close. It's really good. It's really good.
And it's a powder.
And so you just stir it up, drink it down, keep moving with your day.
So before I get too far away from the fish, what about crappie?
Crappie. You talking about crab, lobster, shrimp, all of that good stuff?
And so here we got, Patricia said, what about crappie? And then Ms. Hines says,
I consider myself one of the best fisherwomen in Texas. And I have a
deep freezer full of bass and crappies. I don't know what crappies are. Do you?
I haven't heard of crappies. I'm real honest. What I don't know, I don't know. Now, if she's got a freezer full of sea bass, I need her address so I can come to your house. I will buy it from you. Right. But think about crabs, tilapia, calamari, shrimp. Once again, all of those are high in cholesterol. Yeah. And they taste great, y'all. I know they taste great. I like it. They taste amazing. But they're not good for us. And I say to many, many times when I'm doing consultations with my clients when I first meet them, and we all tend to be about this age, I say, haven't you had enough of stuff that's tasted good? Aren't you ready to feel good? And so, once again, you have to weigh the answer out. And so that's where you go.
Okay, we have about 12 minutes to go. And so probably about 10 minutes, because we got to give our people at the All of Us Research some more screen time.
Well, yes, yes, yes.
And we're going to talk about that a little bit. I want to play a video. I've been hearing a lot of people my age or our age group who are dealing with blood pressure issues. Mm-hmm. So I'll play a clip, and I want you to kind of address that a little bit.
Okay. Here we go. Let me give you a great on blood pressure. I don't know how many of you out there are challenged with it on a day-to-day basis, but here's a simple little tip about blood pressure and how you can kind of get it under control. First off, celery, guys. Just celery. Celery is equivalent to a blood pressure pill. Now, am I saying to eat this celery every day? No. What I'm to do is get a blender. You can get a if you've got a bullet, if you've got a ninja, or even if you've got a Vitamix. Blend it up, add a little mix, because if you're a celery fan, it's going to be a little bitter. But then you drink it. And what that does is it allows your blood pressure to start to stabilize. And so four stalks of celery, everybody, is equivalent to a blood pressure pill.
Well, you know, blood pressure. First, I want to shout out to Aaron Draper. Missed his birthday. Good friend of mine from Philadelphia. And I missed the Roots Picnic. And so, Aaron, holla at your boy, man. But yeah, so blood pressure and celery.
But blood pressure and celery have a direct correlation, as you heard in the clip a second ago. Four stalks of celery is equivalent to a blood pressure pill. Now, it's not to eat. You want to blend it. And for those of you that don't like the taste of celery, you can mix an apple or carrots to it, a cranberry juice or something along those natures. But let's get back to what's causing the high blood pressure. You know, we've been talking a lot about dairy this morning. Well, dairy has twice as much cholesterol as any meat. Well, guess what, y'all? What does cholesterol turn into? Cholesterol turns into fat. What triggers blood pressure issues? Too much fat intake. So see, it's all connected. It's all connected together. So when we can get to the root of what's causing it, then it's easy to correct. And so, you know, and then the other thing, Troy, that we talked a lot about in those four classes is just the consumption of clean water. Mm. And many times people say, well, wait a minute, I drink water. What do you mean it's not clean? Well, for water to be clean, guys, it has to have a pH balance of 7 or higher to make it an alkaline water. Because as we're talking about blood pressure, cholesterol, dairy, it's all tied together. When your body becomes more acidic, you become more susceptible to colds, to cancer, virus. We living through a virus right now. And so these are just little simple everyday steps we can make. So change the water that you drink to an alkaline water. There are tons of them out there that you can find.
So, you know,
growing up in the 70s and 80s,
we drank out the water.
The best water was that water from somebody, your neighbor's yard.
Right.
Coming absolutely. Out the ground.
Coming out
right.
the ground.
Coming
right.
out the ground. That, right. Man, if I can bottle that,
right,
I can get it. But I want to play this little clip about people assuming that lemon makes water alkaline. So it's a 30-second clip, and then I want you to address that. And then, you know, what's up with this Dallas tap water? So here we go.
Okay.
Is lemon water alternative to alkaline water?
Lemon water is not an alternative to alkaline water. Let me break this down. People would ask me for years and years and years. Well, Paul, I put lemon in my water. Doesn't that make it alkaline? No. Why? Because you don't know the level of that water that you're consuming. You don't know if that water has a pH of 5, a pH of 4, a pH of 7, or even a negative number pH. So yes, the lemon cleans it a little bit, but it doesn't make it alkaline.
The lemon cleans it a little bit, but it doesn't make it alkaline. Before you answer that, I want you to talk about, can you just eat celery every day? All day, you know, that's what Darlene said. And then, also, what about beet juice? Beet juice scares me because everything you do when you eliminate it, it comes out red.
It comes out red. There you go.
If you forgot you ate some beet juice, you
right, right, right. You, yeah. So, can you eat celery all day? That's a personal choice. If you want to snack on it, you know, I have a new client, guys, just this past week. I'll see them today again. And the first night after we did her meal prep and she ate, now, mind you, this person's blood pressure, Troy, every day was in the 200s. Mm-hmm. The first day it was 121 over 90. In one night, it changed that dramatically.
Wow.
So once again, I'm not gonna say eat celery all day, but the celery, four stalks of celery does help, but we have to make a shift. We have to make a lifestyle shift, you know? So that's where the information and the knowledge and the how-to comes into play. So we can maintain it. We just don't want to do something for 3 weeks or 4 weeks, or even with these cooking shows that we did four of them hoping that it will get you on the path. You know, one of the biggest things that all of us research and the community council wants is to teach you how to have a lifestyle and also provide you with better solutions. So that's why, once again, y'all, we need y'all to go here, click, donate, share, because we need you to make this program ultimately successful.
Dallas sink water.
So tap water. You know, some people say, oh, I just drink tap water. I just drink tap water. Well, there is no tap water that's clean because just our environment now has gotten so polluted. And when it comes to some people say, well, I put a lemon in my water to make it alkaline. No, that's one of those things that people say that's not accurate, because we don't know the level of this water. We don't know the level of acidity of this water. So yes, adding a lemon to it helps it somewhat, but it doesn't make it alkaline because we don't know the level of how acidic slash, if we use simple language, how dirty the water really is.
Back to everything you've been saying, Tamarnall says it's a lifestyle.
It's a lifestyle.
It's not a diet.
It's not a diet. It's a lifestyle.
It's something you have to just implement and keep it going.
Keep it going. You know, you will go on vacation. You will travel. You'll go out and have things. But then when you come back in your home, you know, you want to just get back on track. That's why, you know, through those four cooking classes, we talked about some things you want to minimize, like the high fructose corn syrup. So you'll eat it when you're out. You're going to eat it when you're out, but you don't have to have it in your home. You don't have to have the artificial coloring on your foods, your cereals, the different things like that in your home. So when we can just keep our home environment really high, then when we go out, travel, celebrate friends, birthday, this is graduation season. I have been to more barbecues. I have had more barbecue chicken, y'all, than I care to stand lately.
People always ask who made the potato salad.
Oh, right.
Everybody can't barbecue chicken.
Yeah, so we just have to have a lifestyle of making good choices.
Well, I'm going to bring one of our all of us research people on the screen with me. How you doing, Mike?
Hey, pretty good, Troy. How are yourself?
Cool, man. We've had a great time on this show with Paul and all. We got questions, and hopefully people have a few more questions in this last 3 or 4 minutes. But I wanted to bring you up to kind of show us and talk to us about the community council and all of us research.
Right. No, well, it's been a great show. So again, thank you to Paul. Thank you to you, Troy. And yeah, I just want to start with that. Thank you to you guys, nutritionist Paul Ritter and producer Troy Knowles, for putting this great show together on behalf of the Community Council of Greater Dallas. It's definitely been a pleasure partnering up alongside them to bring this type of content to our community. And I just want to ask our viewers to please visit Community Council's website at www.ccadvance.org and learn more about all the different services that we offer to the community, as well as visit and learn more about the All of Us research program at www.joinallofus.org/togetherdallas. Or you can call Baylor Scott and White at 844-487-2794. And yeah, just thank you all for tuning in to the Conversation with the Chef and being a part of the conversation. And just, again, just take care, and we'll be seeing you guys again soon.
I want to thank you. I want to thank everybody at the Community Council, all of us. Lucia, this has been fun.
Been a blast.
And you know what? I tell you what, everybody who's listening, this is like this is the recap. You know what I mean? That means
right.
It's ending.
It's over.
But you know, I see people watching these reality shows, and then they have a season two. So hopefully. We're up for renewal season 2. What do you think about, Paul? You ready for season 2?
We want to come back for season 2. So all of you that have watched these shows, hit them, tell them you want a second season so we can share more, do more, teach more. It has been my pleasure. Stay tuned. Follow me on all my different social medias. I got some great things coming up on YouTube. So follow me. Have a great Friday. Love y'all.
And I think we got a couple of minutes, and I don't know if Patricia's coming back on, but you know, I just want to share that, like when you do eat well, this happened to me. Then I went back and ate bad. I think, where did we go? We went somewhere and tried to eat how we used to eat, and it just don't work. So you know, changing your when you eat clean, when you go back to eat dirty, I'm gonna tell y'all where I went. All right, do not judge me. But every so often. You know, I have I love being around elders and older Black people.
Uh-huh.
And the best place to find them is at Luby's on 67. hey, they got assigned seats and everything, right? And I went and had some chicken fried chicken, some navy beans, some mashed potato with gravy. And I got halfway through that. And I started feeling sick.
Right. Stomach just was like, okay, enough is enough.
No, we don't do this no
more. We don't do this no more. Stop.
So what is that? What is it about eating clean that makes you, you know, makes your body?
Well, because when you start eating cleaner, you're generally eliminating the salts, the fats, the artificial colors, the artificial products in food. And because we were created never to consume that, then when you start putting it back in, it's like an alarm. Bell goes off, but like body's like, hey, stop.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah. But the bigger issue is, Troy, when you're not eating clean or whatever, you can eat that stuff every day and it never bothers you. Mm. Because the body will adapt.
Will adapt.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. Will adapt.
Well, look, we're here. This is our team. I got a graphic up of Jessica Walker, Patricia Johnson, and Miguel Trejo, and I hope I said that right. I just want to say thank you.
Thank y'all.
Thank you for the community council for bringing us on, and for everyone who's viewing. You know, I'm going to go have bad food today, but I encourage you to eat well. I've been eating good, you know, all week. I've been eating hummus and carrots, and I'm spinached out. If I don't see another piece of spinach, I'll be good. Paul, you want to say anything before we get up out of here?
Once again, follow me on all my pages, PRitter23 on Instagram, Paul Ritter Facebook. I've got a dynamic series coming up on YouTube with Jonathan Evans. So if you don't know who that is, go follow Jonathan Blake Evans on Instagram. We've got an amazing series. We've done 2 episodes. We got 2 more on how to treat your temple, faith, and food. Check us out. Love y'all. Stay safe. See you for season 2.
All right, we out.